Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to this webinar organized by Macquarie Telecom. I'm Pierre Linzer from the marketing team, and it is my pleasure to introduce you to Dean Foster, who is our technical lead here in the hosting division at Macquarie Telecom. Hi, Dean, how are you?
I'm well, thank you, Pierre. Fantastic day, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. Great to hear, Dean. So I just have a quick couple of housekeeping items I need to go through before we start. So to the audience, at any point in time, if you have a question, you can raise it by typing it in the chat section or in the questions section of the app control panel. We'll take some time to answer them at the end of the presentation. The second item is that we will run a quick poll about halfway through the webinar. The question will pop up on your screens, and you'll have about 10 seconds to answer it. So, Dean, today we're going to learn pretty cool things about VMware technology and how it integrates with our data center infrastructure. Is that correct?
Well, certainly is, Pierre. Look, we introduced this technology at vForum a couple of weeks ago. With the feedback we received, we wanted to actually be able to talk to both our customers and our prospects and users of the technology a little bit more. So that's what we're talking about today. So it's extending your data center to the cloud. I'm probably going to talk for about 30, 35 minutes, and as Pierre mentioned, we'll have some time for questions just at the end of the webinar. So look, before we go too much further, I do just want to introduce myself. Finally, as I said, my name is Dean Foster. I'm actually the hosting technical director at Macquarie Telecom. My background is as an engineer, and I do work hands-on with technology. And I basically have been working over the years to build and support the needs of business customers for about the last 25 years. Now, I've actually been here at Macquarie Telecom for about 15 of those years, including working up in Singapore as CTO up there. So I've led all of the technical development and deployment functions pretty much for every major investment Macquarie has had. So that covers data centers, voice ATM networks, IP networks, online portals and solutions, and most recently I've focused on product marketing roles. So I like to call myself a bit of a technologist. I really do love technology. I use it in my home life and my work life, and I like to see basically how to make life easier using technology. Now, just introducing Macquarie Telecom, we're Australia's leading managed hosting cloud and telecommunications provider for both business and government customers in Australia. We do work through our delivery of service excellence for this, so we're not sort of one of the big conglomerates that are just focusing on public services. So for those that are not familiar with the brand, we work directly with corporate IT companies, web and software providers, basically to build the infrastructure that run their business. And we even provide internet for about a third of the government. So we're not a large marketing firm, but we prefer to deal directly with those CIO and IT managers who can benefit most from serviced infrastructure. And we focus our services on four areas. Now, firstly, we're an infrastructure provider. So we've got cloud products, dedicated environments, co-location services. We do this over multiple locations in our data centers. And overall, we've got about 56 different products in our catalog. So we can really find anything there to meet customer needs. Now next, we're a services business. And we front our managed services with real engineers who answer the phone and can be called upon to do any number of runbook service operations. We're focused heavily on our customer services, and we've won many customer service awards for this, most particularly last year. And we've got a particular focus on net promoter score so that we're able to measure and feed back and improve our customer service levels. Now thirdly, we have our own data centres. And we call this as a brand IntelliCentres. We've got over $200 million of investment into our infrastructure, and we even support the federal government services in our highly secure IntelliCentre 4 bunker located in Canberra. But these hosting components, services and facilities, we actually wrap those up into solutions. And it's these solutions that solve real-world business problems for customers and it's able to expand their opportunities and grow their businesses. So we're not about widgets picked out of an online catalogue, but we work closely with customers to provide unique custom solutions to meet any of their current IT challenges or opportunities that might exist. That's actually one of these solutions that I'm going to focus on today. This is our data center extension solutions and how you can extend to connect to the cloud. So let's look at why you might extend your data center. So we want to sort of think about the reasons why data centers start to get full. Now, we talk to a lot of customers in corporate IT business all around Australia, and the most common thing we hear is the lack of power. So the data centres, you know, carry the core of the IT business. In our first data centre, we actually engineered the site to carry about 1.5 kilowatts per square metre. Now, that was about 10 years ago. Just recently, our data centre in Telecentre 2, that's increased from 1.5 up to 3.5 kilowatts per square metre. Now, that's a major change. And when you walk around the data centre, you can actually see that. So all of a sudden, all of the wall space is now taken up with power boards and breakout boards, and the underfloor cabling services are huge compared to many years ago. And besides the space that power takes up inside the data centre, it turns out that many buildings that support these, they were never intended to support data centres. So increasing a building from, you know, 2 megawatts to 2.5 megawatts can actually be a huge undertaking. And often the power company will require new feeds or transformers, and these themselves need space inside the building. It can be hundreds of thousands of dollars. And this is all because the density of equipment power is increasing. So I've actually seen half full data centres that have plenty of space, but they've actually maxed out their power requirements and they can't add any more IT infrastructure. Now, cooling is the next issue with data centres. So along with that increase in power, also the increase in cooling needs to happen as well. So many raised floors are not deep enough to handle the air throughput for the racks, particularly above 5 kilowatts, which is what you get when you start to add lots of blade chassis. And some type of cold or hot aisle containment needs to be retrofitted or even supplementary cooling. But even if you're going to the step of adding new coolers or dedicated in-row coolers, you've still got problems of chilled water. So now all of a sudden you're looking at your rooftop space to see if you've got room to place new chilled waters containers. Now this whole power and cooling problem was meant to be solved by new equipment, because we hear that new equipment much more greener, much more efficient than the equipment that it replaced. But in reality, when we talk to our companies, they've actually failed to turn off the older infrastructure, because there's still some application that they can't move off it, or they've got some concept where they're trying to expand the lifespan of their old infrastructure. But in reality, that's just adding to the problems. Now finally, businesses just do expand. So as they might grow either with their own growth, or sometimes they buy out other businesses just with inorganic growth, so they essentially need more space. So when you look at these three reasons together, so that's why data centres fill up these days. Now, even if your data centre is at capacity, that is now a huge risk to the business, because typically your power loads are at maximum, and any safety or redundancy overheads that you may have had no longer exist. Now, quite thankfully, it's been a long while since we've heard of whole data centre failures, but it's still very common to hear of individual racks or rows failing as a circuit breaker trips. So with these full data centres, what options do we have once they're full? So firstly, you can actually just build a new data centre. Now this is really the $10 million sledgehammer solution. Now I've been involved building about 4 to 5 data centres over the years, and a premium data centre is about $12 million per megawatt. A lower quality data centre is still about sort of $5 to $7 million. So this can take up to a year to deploy. So it's actually a huge cost to the business. But then you can only go on that journey when you actually found the site. And I know recently in Canberra, when we were searching for space up there, we looked at about 8 different locations, and we did full costings on 3, and the whole process took about 8 months before we found the piece of land that we wanted to deploy our data centre on. Now the next one, expanding or refitting your data centre, now that's an option many customers have, because they still might have some spare office space available. But in reality, with all of the time and effort that you're going to put in to try and expand your data centre, you really need to double the size of it to make all that effort worthwhile. Now you can refit different components, different power and cooling components, but what we've seen also only adds about 30 to 40% more overhead. So it really is only a short time solution for your business. So the last option is where Macquarie focuses is where you extend your data centre into another facility owned by someone else. So this means that all of a sudden you're spending OPEX to lease space instead of CAPEX to build your own data center. Now expanding into another data center means that you will never need to expand your own data center again, because the service provider will have virtually unlimited space to expand into. And it even opens up the possibility in the future of possibly closing down your own data center, because that just might not be your core business. Now extending your data center, however, is still a risky solution, because you're trusting that provider with your core IT infrastructure. So now solving risk is the most important part of your project. Risk that the infrastructure is solid and capable, risk that the company won't go bust or close down or sell, risk that the provider has people that actually know what they're doing. Now we're going to talk about risk a little bit later, but let's explore first what actually happens when you extend your data center. So the technical solution on how to extend your data center actually seems quite straightforward, but there's actually a few traps that I do want to explore. So at a high level, you simply connect the second data center with some type of a network layer. Now with that in place, providing it's a high performance solution, you've got access to all of the resources available in the second data center. But what data center should you choose? Now this is where you need to work closely with those that are in the market, because you need to find a data center that's available to ensure that you're not limiting your options in the future. So what you want to look at is choosing someone with a wide range of platforms. So if you look at just plain colo centers, they might have the racks, but in future they might not have the cloud services you need to expand to. If you look at just cloud data centers, they might not have the high performance dedicated compute solutions that could also benefit you in the future. So where you're talking to your server provider, you're looking at a wide range of products. Now having all of these options is actually beneficial to your business, because in your own data center you typically have a fixed price per gigahertz for running all your applications. And that's essentially the sum of all of the cost of your infrastructure, management, people, hardware, CPUs. Now having that single fixed cost can actually be limiting to many organizations, because you've got applications that are mission critical down to just sort of test or lab environments, and they're all sitting on the same platforms. Now imagine if you have access to different costs that you can apply to the different applications that you have. So that's where having more options can be beneficial. Now if I look back at the diagram that I have here, I can actually start to see that this network component is really the magic that's making all that happen. But when you're choosing your network component, there are actually a few traps that you can fall into. So I want to explore that. Now why is this network choice so important? Now it's based on a simple technology called Layer 2 transport. So this is the LAN technology that already exists in your data center. So this is essentially the blue cable that connects everything together. Now ideally when you extend your data center, you also want to extend this layer 2 service, because then you can keep all of your networks untouched. It also means that all of your security zones stay the same and all of your IP addresses of the servers can stay the same. So with layer 2, an application can be on-site or off-site and the users would not actually know it. Now if you extend your data center without this layer 2 technology, and now we're talking about either layer 3 or even some Ethernet services don't allow you to have layer 2, now all of a sudden you're introducing changes in your environment. So now the VLAN numbers may be different, a firewall may be needed to provide security, and IP and subnets are all different. So with layer 2, however, look, when you look at layer 2, even if fiber is not available, there are still ways to access layer 3. Now even some types of Ethernet technology that's available, and there are a lot of Ethernet providers now who can offer this Metro Ethernet product, you need to ensure that they can support the layer 2 tunneling that you require, because you need to get your VLANs through that service. Now Macquarie has the unique ability to make these layer 2 dreams come true in many different scenarios. Firstly, we're a carrier and we have access to our own fiber, our partner fibers, pretty much in every location through 36 different carriers. Secondly, we deploy the very latest VMware technology that actually allows us to bring this layer 2 network over non-compatible WAN or Ethernet networks, so that with Macquarie we can actually solve this data center extension solution in more ways than anyone else. And it's this layer 2 over layer 3 that I do want to explore some more. Now, the technology to extend layer 2 over layer 3 is actually pretty new in the market. There's been a few providers who tried it many years ago, but they typically required complex IPsec or security solutions, which have got some very interesting licensing impacts. Now, Macquarie was the very first service provider to bring the VMware NSX technology to the market. And this was a major upgrade to the virtual network technology that is built inside the VMware hypervisor. And because it's supported by VMware, it's not a tack-on technology that has limited support, but it's actually a standard module that you simply just install using the existing software. Now, this NSX technology supports what they call VXLAN translation, which essentially means that I can extend any of the layer 2 VLANs from one site to another site. Now, it's not a simple task as it sort of may seem, because layer 2 has lots of challenges with broadcast domains, MAC address translation, and all of this is carefully considered by the software. But we believe that VMware have nailed it. So even if you have a layer 3 routed network, or maybe you've got a metro Ethernet service that doesn't support layer 3, with Macquarie we can still extend the layer 2 network domains across these data centers and into your own data center. So now we've discussed the challenges of full data centers and how you can sort of extend beyond them, there actually are some other main reasons why you may want to extend your data center, even if it's not full. Now, we're going to call this extend to the cloud, and that's the topic of the webinar today. So cloud is currently the buzzword, and it's driving many of the IT decisions these days. This has been a trend in businesses for many years, and even though the hype cycle is definitely over and reality is starting to bite, many boards and companies across Australia still adopt a cloud-forward policy for IT, which, thank goodness, many IT managers turn into a hybrid IT strategy where they actually look at each application on their own merits and then determine whether or not it needs to go to the cloud or not. Now, extending your data center to Macquarie actually means that the cloud is in very close reach to you. Now, Macquarie Launch Cloud is a cloud solution based on VMware technology. It's got the standard cloud features that you expect with low commitments, unlimited expansion and growth possibilities. It's a low-cost platform, and there's portals to put you in control. Now, this vCloud technology is a major technology play for Macquarie, as it's completely compatible with the environments that a majority of corporate Australia is running. So quite simply, a virtual machine running in your own environment can simply be loaded into our cloud environment without any conversions, driver changes, code rewrites, or even IP change. Now, it's important to recognise that this is actually not possible with some of the larger cloud providers. For instance, the AWS AMI format, that's not commonly available. You just can't download it and install it in your own data centre. And even the Microsoft Azure environment, their applications still need to go through a one-way conversion process if you're moving away from Hyper-V. Now, while we at Macquarie might talk about data center extension, you can actually label that cloud extension. Because you're extending your data center, it now has seamless access to the cloud. And you can report back to the board that you've begun your journey. And we've seen many companies look to the public cloud at putting these test and dev solutions. But really, it turns out not to be an exact copy of your mission-critical platforms. So, for instance, an Oracle test environment doesn't run particularly well in the public cloud, especially when your own internal solutions are based on VMware. And there's a huge number of variables in quality assurance when you're moving your test and dev into production. It's far better to know that your test environment has the exact operating system, firmware, drivers, and support stacks as your production environment. And if you can make that all VMware, then it starts to eliminate the possibility of software glitches and compatibility issues. Now, last but not least, why would you extend your data center? Is that you actually want to unlock temporary capabilities that might be suitable for specific projects. So we're now talking about those short-term components. Now, imagine if you can run these sort of urgent application needs by different parts of your business on fresh hardware without taking CPU memory away from your mission critical solutions. In particular, if the network layer is dead flat, layer two, you can actually put more capacity into your existing mission critical application. So you simply fire up more application servers in the second data center, and they're all managed by the load balancers. So now all of a sudden you're able to give different cost per gigabyte options to your business. So next time one of your business units come to you and they've got another need for an application, you can offer them the $2 option, the $20 option, or even the $200 option. And this is fantastic for internal business managers. So these elements are just some of the reasons why customers want to extend out of their existing data centers. Now each one of these has different drivers and return on investments, and our consulting teams are happy to talk to you because they're familiar with many of the different ways that businesses can represent value. So I'm going to pause there for a sec because I actually want to hear from you about why you're running out of space in your own data center or why you're looking at possibly extending your data center into the cloud. So hand back to Pierre.
Thanks, Dean. I'm going to quickly take control to launch the poll question. Now, I think the attendees can see the poll question. If you, we're going to give them about 10, 15 seconds to read through the answers and answer the question.
So please, those over there, just click on one of the options.
All right, another few seconds. All right, I'm closing the poll now, and let's share the results.
Fantastic. So, there's a few different results there. So from access to the cloud to extra space. Interesting there, I do pick up that actually not many people are running out of physical space, because I think we're seeing that definitely in the market when our customers come to us. It's more about they run out of cooling or they run out of something else. It's not actual space that's their problem. But it's good to know that customers want to get to the cloud. Journey to the cloud is certainly a major focus at the moment.
Yep. Handing back to you, Dean.
Beautiful. So we've talked about why you'd want to extend your data center. Now I actually want to refer to a specific customer of ours that has actually done this. And they've taken us on a bit of the journey as well with them. So I want to share you the one recent customer experience, and this is one of our large media organisations, and they've had continual expansion of their data centre space over the many years. And even Macquarie was involved in some of these projects. Now at board level for them, this was a frustrating process. Because their business kept on coming back wanting more changes to the data centre. Sorry, just correcting that. So we were able to make use of dark fiber to extend their customers' rack space into our self-managed launch cloud environment. And the key to this that they enjoyed was that we were able to map all of their existing VLAN and security zones into our cloud instance. So it was all running as layer two. So it actually meant that their IP subnets were all the same. So they didn't need firewalls. So we were truly an extension to their existing data center. Now, this was all fantastic and they had access to a whole host of new resources and products, but they actually wanted to migrate. Now, when they looked at other data center solutions, they actually realized that migration was going to be a larger cost to the business than even the data center itself, particularly if they looked at moving to public cloud. Because that meant they had to then have a change of IP addresses, change of stack, change of firmwares. It was actually quite a large project that was going to cost them many millions of dollars. So when we started to look at this project, we realized that migrations in this environment was going to be the key to this being a success. And the customer had many hundreds of virtual machines that they wanted to move. And they knew that this was going to be a long time. So when we start to look at what happened, we actually had to put together a specific migration toolset for this customer in that we've based this on VMware technology. We've now made it to the whole market, and I'm going to talk a little bit about that some more. Now, typically within a data center, when you start to extend it, you need to move your workloads. So what you find is that actually or a copy or export a template. Now, if that's a 100 gigabyte machine, that can take some time. That might be 10 minutes or maybe up to an hour. The next step is you've got to copy that over to the new location. Then you've got to import it again. That also takes time. And then finally, you turn it on. So for one virtual machine, that might be 30 minutes to 2 hours. And now imagine doing that for 50 virtual machines in a row. Now, for anyone who's done this, anyone here who has done this, you certainly realize that this is not something you can do in parallel. If you kick them all off at once, it's simply going to choke the network, choke the storage system. So it has to be done one virtual machine at a time. And you do have to constantly watch it. Now, at Macquarie, we make use of a specific tool set from a vendor called Zerto. And this is completely compatible with the VMware environment. Now, we've got a large investment in this technology, and it's available in all of our availability zones and all of our data centers, and it works across a number of solutions. So let's talk about how it works. So the first step is to actually install the software. So it installs itself as a virtual machine. It does connect to the hypervisor. And then it connects back to the Macquarie environment in our data center. Now there's a web portal which the customer has access to. And in that web portal, you simply select the virtual machines that you want to migrate. And basically the process starts. So the next step is the software runs a synchronization activity, which over time it begins to build a shadow of the server in the Macquarie environment. Now it can take some time, but this is okay because the application is still turned on, it's still running. Now the software doesn't care if the application, what it's doing or whatever it's database or whether it's some type of application server. It basically starts to slowly copy that virtual machine at a hypervisor level. Now this technology is very similar to the standard VMware vMotion technology, but this actually works across separated VMware environments. Now the next step, eventually the two machines are brought into sync and they're continually kept in sync by the software, even as the application is running. The software via the hypervisor intercepts all of the disk activity so that there's no application code changes or agents or drivers that need to be installed on the virtual machine. Now it's this synchronization activity that's the clever part of the technology because it's caching requests, it's deduping them, it's copying them to the shadow VM. It needs a modest amount of network bandwidth to operate, but based on standard applications in our environments, contain about a 5 minute synchronization window. And that's enough for many users. So now everything's in sync. It's finally up to the migration time. So with a single press of the button, the machines in the old data center are deactivated and the new ones are fired up. The IP addresses don't change. And now all of a sudden the applications, they just receive a very short outage and the users are back going again. And this technology can move up to 50 virtual machines at a time or even more. So now all of a sudden migrations are infrastructure migrations and you don't need software or development teams to move your applications. So that's the migration you set. And the one clear advantage of this is the ability to move multiple workloads at once. So we realise that downtime is important for customers and they want to reduce it as much as possible, and that's where this migration toolset can clearly fit in. So coming to an end, I just want to touch about why Macquarie is so focused on this solution and why it's a fantastic choice, why Macquarie can be a fantastic choice for extending your data centre. So firstly, we have a wide range of infrastructure available. That makes us truly unique. We fully support hybrid IT and our network options are never ending, so you can connect up to any of your environments seamlessly. Now on top of just extending your platform, we can offer high availability internet or network options. We also have security solutions with DDoS protection, intrusion prevention. Now our launch suite, it covers the compute components and these are available in all of our locations. When you use them that way, you can get them with up to 100% availability guarantee. And that's something that you can pass on to your customers. We're also an experienced partner. So when you start to work with Macquarie, you realise that you see the passion in our people, and these people want to make a difference to your business. And when this passion is backed by the experience and capability, they can actually achieve fantastic things. So we can make this technology work. So we've got hundreds of business customers, exactly like your own business, and they depend on us for their own mission-critical hosting. We work with IT departments as partners, and we're available on the phone, and we're intimate with your environment and your requirements. So you can ask us any questions, and we'll get more out of your environment or offer more thoughts on us for any of the business problems that you may face. And finally, our customer sort of focus is also award-winning. It's fantastic that we've been able to win that award, and we've certainly had fantastic feedback internally. And we use our Net Promoter Score to keep on continually improving and measuring how we're performing in that customer service. And soon you'll be able to see those statistics on our website. So earlier I mentioned about working with a partner that can have low risk. And certainly in Macquarie, risk is a key item that we focus to be able to de-risk it. Ultimately, we understand that risk is a key consideration involved with any partner that's going to carry your application workloads. So we focus on four main areas. So first off, we have a high availability network infrastructure and design. This is where the promise starts. And this is focusing on our building, powers and racks. Next, we have people who are certified. They know what they're doing, they're experienced and they're hands-on. And we don't make mistakes and put components at risk. Macquarie is actually 70% certified engineers. So we've got the people who can support your needs at any time. Next, we do have the systems, tools and processes. And these are backed by our annual ISO 27001 audits and confirms that these are in place and operating. And from a security access to capacity management, all of these processes are tested. These are not just a tick box to say that we do them. And finally, we've got the service level guarantees, which are at 100% for our launch solutions across multiple sites, some of the highest in the market. Now, Macquarie is one of the three providers that support the most risk-averse business in the world, and that's federal government. So that's our ultimate proof point that we're effective in what we do. And we've got 15 years of experience and hundreds of customers that can actually prove that. So that's fine from me, all from me. I'm going to hand back to Pierre to run some questions. Now, I'm seeing a few chats going on. Pierre, do we have some questions from anyone?
Thank you. It is very costly to put in redundant fiber links. Do most customers do this?
Well, that's very interesting. Look, you build redundancy to make sure that you're not going to have challenges should your actual data center fail. So, fiber links at the very part of the stack is one way to do redundancy. There's many other ways to do redundancy. We can do redundancy through the application layer, through server load balancers on the internet. So if fiber access is proving costly to put in a second access, there are different options to make it work. When you're dealing with layer two, it is recommended that your redundant access is the same technology. So over Ethernet, when you're primary link fiber, you need to be very careful with how that network solution is designed.
We have one final from the audience. Can I extend it to just plain racks as well as cloud at the same time?
Yeah. So the one of the good things with layer two technology is that it is very, very simple technology. Your rack can connect those same VLANs into a dedicated server environment. So it is actually possible to build up a quite a complex layer 2 network. Now, for anybody who's worked in layer 2, you need to be careful with the design of it, with the switching domains and the broadcast domains can be quite tricky. But the technology that's in use today is built to overcome those limitations. So, yeah, you can extend from racks into public cloud back into your own data center.
Thank you, Dean. And that was our last question. So I want to thank you first, Dean, for that great presentation you gave us. I think there was some pretty cool insights in there. And I want to congratulate as well the audience for spending the last 45 minutes with us.
Yes, thank you.
Thanks, everyone. We know that if you came that far, you're extremely committed to the success of your business and would like to help. So we'll be in touch with you very shortly after the webinar with you to discuss your specific needs. Presentation today, and have an awesome day.
Thank you, everybody. Bye.